Okay, thanks everyone. It's good to see people back from lunch. We're going to start our panel on conservation governance, the third of this topic. And we have all our presenters here this afternoon, and we'll have some co-presented presentations here. We're going to start with Mordecai Ogada with ICAN and ACC, as well as Jacques Pollini of McGill University. And they're going to be speaking on the topic with the question, are communities interests protected in the context of internationally funded conservancies, case studies from northern Kenya? And so we'll start with Mordecai.
Thank you and good afternoon to everyone. We're going to look at, obviously, northern and southern Kenya, which have slightly different challenges, but I'll look at northern Kenya and then hand over to Jacques in the second half of this presentation to look at to highlight some of the issues in southern Kenya. Community conservancies are the new big thing in northern Kenya, and I've been called the panacea to most of the conservation challenges, but for various reasons, we are needing to look closer at whose interests exactly these conservancies are serving. One of the key things is that we need to change definitions or paradigms, because sometimes the definitions are not necessarily wrong, but it's what people believe about them. And one of the things is conservation and the way in Kenya the principle of conservation and the business of tourism sort of bleed into each other and leave vital people falling through the cracks. We must escape the grip of its origins. And the origins of these practices in Kenya and many African countries is the root of the problems we face today. And there's a reason why I'm using the pith helmet to illustrate that. This was a very potent symbol, still is in Africa, of domination. And the fact is, the origins of tourism and conservation are based largely in the oppression of local people. This in East Africa. So we have examples like in a really bad drought in 1961 Kenya, where there were desperate attempts to keep wild animals alive while at the same time pushing desperate pastoralists and their animals out of the quote unquote conservation areas. There were lots of arrests of quote unquote poachers drying quote-unquote bush meat at camps in the bush while sportsmen were hunting endangered species and paying big money and having taxidermy done for them. So these are the origins. This is where we are coming from. The differences are more subtle now, but they're still there, and everyone seems to buy into them. Very contemporary literature has sorts of feel-good things like this, heartwarming photo essay, Kenyans protecting their wildlife. A man sleeping in a stable with a rhino is not a Kenyan protecting wildlife. It's a position of extraordinary indignity for someone who should be at home with his family. That rhino is in a stable in a protected area. It's not in any danger. Not that a baby rhino has any horn for poachers to take anyway. But the fact is, conservation practice in sub-Saharan Africa is still really steeped in racism, and we must wake up to that fact. A lot of times, and in my view, too many times, when we talk of conservation challenges, ecologists, and this is my background, I keep hearing there's too many people. That's the problem. As I illustrate with that picture, there's too many people where wildlife should be. Well, unless you are planning to shoot them, we should not have that discussion. And if you're planning to shoot them, we'll have another discussion. But the fact is, there's this glib reference to local people as somehow a nuisance, yet if they were not pro-wildlife, there would not be any wildlife to conserve in the first place. So commonly you hear that, okay, we are mismanaging the wildlife areas and we need to have a new plan i.e. conservancies with management plans, small high-end facilities, higher fees, often over $100 per person for entry, grazing restrictions, very strict, and I quote from a real management plan, you only let in green four-wheel drive vehicles. This exists in the management plan. So at the end of the day, only people like those can enjoy this wildlife. The communities that live around there, often the pastoralist communities, are restricted to the peripheries of this land, and their interaction with tourism is restricted to choreographed dances and visits to quote-unquote cultural villages, while tourism is practiced in splendid isolation with wildlife and not a human being or structure in sight. Where does this leave the young local people with non-green colored cars? Who are the people we expect to conserve these resources for posterity? They don't take part in the discourse, and they are left out in all this planning and too many people, since tourism seems to be targeted only at foreigners. A lot of practice of tourism is reminiscent of that picture from John Speke's travels. This was an explorer in Uganda, where he'd be carried on his parasol, reading a book and saying he's exploring, while others are he's being carried on the shoulders of some local people. So you might think this is long ago in antiquity. That's Uganda 2015. So we say tourism provides employment, but employment is not just for money. Employment that does not dignify people, I think, is useless. I think everybody here who works in various jobs does so not just for the money, but for the dignity and satisfaction you get out of it. But tourism ignores this. Too often Africans are props. This is a very contemporary, current tourism brochure. Why is the African not wearing a shirt? He's just a prop as much as the elephant or the acacia trees. He's not an intellectual participant in what's going on there. And this is the root of the problem that is sadly accepted everywhere. And if you look at the top right corner, there's a map of Kenya that shows you where these two details are from. Now, this is the Northern Rangelands Trust conservancies, series of conservancies that covers about 12%, over 12% of Kenya's total landmass. And they're called community conservancies, yet they're managed by external parties. Thanks. But you see, if you look carefully, the area they cover follows the path of this development, these Vision 2030 development modules within those areas. And these are the people firmly in control of these are resources that will come into these areas because they sort of own the natural resource discourse in those places. That's a detail I'll invite you to look at on the NRT website. Basically, it's a cattle trading system. But just to summarize, the key thing is that they buy cattle from community members who adhere to NRT's strict grazing policies, as you see written at the top there. And then the money and profits are plowed back into NRT trading. So NRT buys at lower price, sells at higher price, and uses the profits to manage this land. The net effect of that is just removing cattle from the landscape. And we know subjugation of people is by removing what they depend on. This is an allegory I'll close with. This photograph shows a man there. There's the pith helmet. Down there you have a zebra representing tourism dollars, philanthropy donations to the natives. You have the tourism industry next to him doing whatever he likes and not protesting at anything. You have ignorant communities and all sharing one zebra or one pot amongst themselves, and that is pittances, gate fees, lease fees. You have Kenya Wildlife Service statutory authority, that's the only other armed party. He's very trusted but very weak on policy. That's us who need to change this discourse. Thank you very much, and I'll let Jacques Pollini take over.
What should I press? Okay, well, it seems that it's maybe not so much hope on the side of community conservation, at least if you look at the way it is practiced in those areas that, that Mordecai presented. So I'm going to turn to maybe other livelihood strategies in the context of livestock system in East Africa. Moving to the south, close to the border with Kenya. So in this area, raising livestock is really a core livelihood strategy, but many changes are occurring. I list them, but I will pass quickly on that because this is a topic we already have been discussed. There were all the other presentations about the pastoralist system in Africa. But basically, diminishing resources, problem of enclosure leading to restriction on mobilities, evolution to more individual way also of managing the resources. So all those difficulties to livestock and mostly the land and resource grabbing that accompany the development of conservation lead to two key challenges. One challenge is to fight and to resist against those social pressure and those land grabbing process that are creating new vulnerabilities, and you can resist by networking, capacity building, social movements. There are different ways. But this is not what I'm going to talk about in this presentation, although it's the most important thing, I believe. But I will talk on the other side, which is, well, and if all this fight and this resistance is lost, then what remains to be done? What can we do in that area that remains available for the livestock people, for the herders, in the context of land and resource grabbing? Well, there are many actually alternatives that we can think about, like conservation tourism, but we saw that on this area we can have quite a depressing view. There's also diversification, agriculture, intensification, migration, education. Those are quickly listed, you know, the various strategies that are adopted by Maasai people. And I will focus on agriculture. I will explain why. So, agriculture doesn't mean you abandon livestock. Agriculture actually can be when I say agriculture, I mean farming, growing crops on the land, can be actually what you need to do if you want to keep your livestock society, your livestock culture and your livestock practices. And this diagram is showing that. So on the left side, you can see how it was before. Maasai people have lots of animals. They have big stock. And if you have many stocks, you can keep the stock constant, and just by selling the surplus or exchanging the surplus, you can sustain your livelihood still keeping your stock constant. It's like having a capital on your bank account, and you use only the annual interest, and you make your living, and you keep your principal, so forever you can maintain your living. Now, because of all those constraints we are talking about, especially in link with conservation, now the herd are much smaller. So the herd cannot generate enough animals to be sold to have this income, this annual income that's necessary for the Maasai. So the needs cannot be satisfied, and there is a decapitalization of the herd. And it's always a challenge to rebuild the herd every time there is a difficult event that arrives, like a drought or like any new difficulties. Like someone falling sick in the family and you have to pay the hospital, sell all the animals. Of course, if you have 20 heads, it's more difficult than if you have 200. So the key question then is how to maximize the capitalization, the rebuilding of the herd, and how to reduce decapitalization, meaning the selling of animals to sustain your livelihood. And what is the area where we can do that in a more efficient way and in a more equitable way, and in a way that is going to be generalizable to at least a broad fraction of the Maasai society? So a tentative answer I got from a few days of fieldwork I did recently in the South, and also from reading into the literature, is that agriculture might actually have quite a potential, maybe more than conservation, to achieve that. And so I'm going to turn then to a few slides showing the agricultural system that were developed in this area I visit in the south. Here you see someone who is actually not a Maasai, he's a migrant, but he's born in the area and he is actually a member of the group ranch, meaning that he is recognized as a member of the community. So this guy developed agriculture, especially orchards, mangoes that are sold in part for export, and also vegetable, like here you can see eggplants. So those are cash crops, and he developed that because there is a potential for irrigation in this area. And here you can see something which is more like subsistence agriculture, where you have corn combined with beans. So actually, I'm sorry, there's two slides that disappeared. Sorry for that, but there is actually an area which is really dedicated to agriculture, and the group ranch, which is this organization gathering, you know, several hundred Maasai family to manage the land together. The group ranch actually comports three areas: an area for wildlife conservation, an area for livestock, and an area for agriculture. And actually, the livestock can also move to wildlife area and to agriculture area. So this area for agriculture has been divided into small plots in a very equal way, into small plots of eight acres per every family, meaning it's a very egalitarian distribution, except for those who are not members. Non-members can be young Maasai who have not yet been included into the registry of the group ranch, and can be also migrants, and most migrants, recent migrants, who are not born into the area are not members. But, so, the point is that there is a potential here to make some land available for farming for every single Maasai family that is living in this area. But there's also a very big challenge, which is that the migrants come into this area precisely because there is that potential for agriculture, and they wait for the opportunity to buy the land, which may happen if, for example, the group ranch is divided into private property into the different members. So there is then a very big challenge for the future of Maasai people, and the question is then, who is going to farm that land in the future? Is it going to be the Maasai people, which will enable them, by producing crops, to reduce the rate of selling their animals? Because if you produce corn, you don't have to sell your goat to buy corn to feed your family. Or is this land going to be cultivated by migrants who, as soon as they will have the opportunity, will buy this land because there are no livestock people, and for them, agriculture is already very clearly the main thing. So I believe that's really the main challenge for the future of Maasai people in this area and in many other places, if I consider literature, meaning if you want to remain a livestock herder on Maasai land, you may need to find a way to shift to also practice some agriculture, to become an agro-pastoralist instead of a pure pastoralist. There is also a potential for integrating, of course, agriculture and livestock, because when you do agriculture, you create new forage resources, like, for example, the stems of the corn that you can give to your cattle, and irrigation enables to create a new landscape where you may have a green grass even during the dry season, and after you harvest your crops, you can get your cattle grazing on this. Okay, there will be many other things to say. I'm skipping on the conclusion, which I anticipate anyway, and I thank you, and we thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, and thank you for staying very close to the time that we have. Next, I'm going to call upon Zhang Qian from the Chinese Academy of Social Sciences, and she has a new title for her presentation, so I'll let her introduce the talk.
Thank you. Good afternoon, and it is a great honor to come here to present our research, and I want to, on behalf of our team, I want to say thank you to John and Colin to invite us here. And we really learned a lot during these days, and I think the most important thing I learned and feel during these days is that some indigenous peoples, they really look like themselves as part of nature instead of look at the nature just as a resource and the tool to survive. So I think to have that common sense, can we only through this common sense can we get to the real sustainability. So as you see, I changed my topic. I think because the original one is my small case study, and I think maybe it is better to introduce our center to you and let you know what we care about and from what perspective we conduct our research. So I changed my topic in climate change and social adaptability, started in pastoral area in the Mongolian. And actually Professor Wang Xiaoyi and Xun Lili is our team member. And our center called the Center for Rural Environmental Social Sciences, Social Studies, was established in 2007. And we emphasize the fieldwork to deeply understand local realities and get the practical knowledge to support practical practices in local communities. And we worked to compare theories and policies with actual practices and to create means for feedback with government policies. And also, we conduct field work in drylands in northern China and also pastoral areas around the Tibetan plateau. And we conduct a study on community-based natural resource management and environmental pollution in rural areas. And we published some of our research work, and also we pay much attention to introduce the theoretical development on rangeland management. So we translate several articles to Chinese scholars. And why climate change? We select this topic because it is long-term change with unexpected extreme events and may produce conflicts. And it has complex reasons for disasters with interaction of biogeographic and socioeconomic factors. And it is a global problem. And it brings more challenges for dry land in both China and Africa, but also provide potential opportunities to strengthen protection of indigenous knowledge. And why social adaptability? Because we must face the reality, and it is difficult to get the agreement of mitigation. But as the climate change happens, we must find the way to adapt to it, and also to reduce disaster risk, and to concern about the vulnerable groups, and to activate functions of local community in disaster prevention and reduction. So background, actually climate change in the Mongolian, took place as in the ways of temperature increase and rainfall decrease. It's very obvious. I will show you data later. And the increase of natural disasters. And during this several decades, and there is very huge socioeconomic change in pastoral areas in northern China. And like pastoralists have settled down and nomadic animal husbandry stopped. The grassland was distributed to individual households and marketization, and also government has invested a lot of huge amount of funds to restore the grassland. So our research objective is to explore how pastoral society copes with increasing climate risks under extensive change. So to summarize climate change characteristics of Inner Mongolia in recent 50 years, to analyze change in pastoralists' coping strategies and to impact on their livelihoods, to explore possible ways to increase herders' adaptability. And you can see because the disasters, they spend a lot of money to buy the fodder and forage. Because the water shortage, they need to transport the water to watering animals. And now here they are making fences around the grassland, and this is the dry river. So we selected six cases in the Mongolia here just across in the Mongolia. And also we conducted a social experiment in the village I will talk about later. And part one, climate change and its risks to Inner Mongolian grassland. Actually, from the perspective of disasters, we can see during these years, there is a continuous drought and snow disasters. And also, we can find the collaborative disasters, which means extreme high temperature in drought and extreme low temperature in Zud, which means no snow disaster. And so actually, this cause worse impacts during these disasters. And also, the disaster chain means if we have drought in summer, it is very likely to have snow disasters in winter because the grass grow very short and even very little snow can cause the food shortage in winter. So this is the temperature change during in this 50 years, and we can see the obvious increase of temperature. And also this is the precipitation. We can see this is the data of two cases, two study cases, and we can see the, this is spring and autumn, and we can see the in spring, because the winter it is still very cold, and normally it is snow. So it is increased. The snow is very heavy, and here it is also winter. You can see the precipitation is high, and here in summer, and this is autumn. This is summer. You can see the obvious decrease, and the impact on livestock breeding. We can see, we can see the continuous decline. After 2000, the year of 2000, the continuous decline of livestock numbers. And also we can see the change of livestock structure because the big animals like horse and cattle decreased. And both national and local government need policies to cope with increasing risk of natural disasters. And part two, social vulnerability and poverty. And due to the pastoralist settlement, grassland distribution and marketization have made pastoralists available grassland shrunk, and the cost of production and living increased and vulnerability increased. Pastoralists exposed to natural disaster directly, which increased their vulnerability. We can see this is a map of the village grassland. This is before the grassland was totally divided to individual households. They use the grassland in small groups. And like this is the water well, and this is the winter camp. And so each group, they use this, they use it in common. And after 1996, they divided the grassland even small, and it was fenced like this. And in the drought, herders have to spend a lot of money to move their livestock. So like, for example, in one case, in 2006, 25 households of our 28 interviewed households moved their livestock, and the cost accounted for 20% of total cost. Half household lost money that year, and they compared to the because in the past they moved the livestock freely, and but now they must pay rent in fee, and it is very high. And we can see that they must to even watering livestock, they need to spend money. So the reciprocal relationship has decreased. And we can find poverty trap and the elite capture increased wealth disparity among after continuous disasters. In some villages, nearly 50% household have no livestock, and many households have to use loan or even usury to buy fodder and forage. And the part three, extensive exploitation of natural resource and grassland degradation. So the government promotes groundwater resource exploration with goodwill, but it caused grassland ecosystem degradation. And also mining is another factor. And part four, social adaptability to climate change. So local pastoralists have coped with climate passively and led to adaptability decrease. But actually, community has significant role. And the community-based natural resource management need not only community itself, but also outside support, which means the institutional environment has played a very important role in CBNRM. For example, this is the hierarchical framework of CBNRM. So for the first level, like a herder group established. And also, on the second level, we need a reciprocal network. Whenever there is a disaster, they can have quick response to move their livestock. And also, for provincial and local government, they can provide information and techniques, something like that. So that is the community-based natural grassland management. And also, I give you an example of a village. Because the grassland was degraded, so the government issued the grazing ban. They forbidden the herder to graze their livestock. So in this village, the herders, this is their village, and they only use this small part of grassland. Because whenever there is government official come to check, so they can go back quickly. So the remote areas, they don't use it. And after, so we want to make some social experiment here. So we bring government officials of different departments and villagers together to communicate. And at last, the villagers agreed to control their livestock number. And the government agreed that, okay, if you control it well, and we will not punish you. So they can make the grassland plan. Use plan like this, and also after 2 years, they improve the plan. So that is a kind of, we can see the local community have the ability to use it reasonably. So discussion is about the increased vulnerability, and we need to find ways to adjust to local situation and promote capacity building. And that's all. Thank you very much.
Wonderful, thank you for that presentation. Next we're gonna move on to Johnson Ole Kaunga with Impact and Evans Kirigia of McGill University, and I think we're starting with Evans. Yes.
Hamjambo. Bonjour. Good afternoon, everyone. So in the next couple of minutes, John and I will be presenting to you a little bit more about mobility, conflicts, and land rights in Laikipia. And this is one of the most interesting parts in Kenya, and so I hope that you'll learn a lot at the end of this afternoon. And okay. So without much ado, I'll go to the next. So on the left side, you can see the map of Kenya, and that's where Laikipia County is located. And then on the right side, we can see the map of Laikipia County. And it's quite a big county in Kenya, and the total area is more than 9,000 square kilometers, and it's now more than 400,000 people, population-wise. Thank you. Perfect. So in this area where we'll be talking about conflicts and mobility, I would like to tell you a little bit more about the livelihoods, modes of livelihoods and beyond also pastoralism, because in the whole of this debate or these discussions, some aspects have taken more center stage, but as well we would like to capture more of the people's livelihoods for you to have a better context of what's going on in the areas they're talking about. So when you talk about Laikipia, we have different modes of livelihoods, and first one is smallholder farming. Second one is more of pastoralism, which will delve deeper into, I'm sure John will go deeper into that. We have large-scale farming in the form of multinational horticultural farms and floriculture farms, which provide employment in those places. So you have not only people farming, but also people settling there and working in those international farms. Then you have commercial ranches, and Laikipia is one of the biggest beef-producing areas in Kenya. And next to that, then you come to tourism, and it's here that this is quite a huge sector in the county. And tied to that is also conservation, and this comes in terms of where, with the other point of holiday homes, you have people coming in and buying huge chunks of land. And so you may have groups of like 10 immigrants buying thousands of acres and having holiday homes on one side. Well, on the other side, the rest of the land is meant for conservation. And then you also have a lot of conservancies. And in these conservancies, they provide employment either in terms of rangers, like Mordecai was pointing out, and also in the tourist sector, you have employment coming in through that way. So you have a lot of diverse modes of livelihoods among the people living there. And also then you have the business people of all kinds, and mainly small enterprises. And so what I mean with this is for you to understand that even when we talk about pastoral areas and pastoral groups being nomadic, we also have other livelihoods that take place in those areas. And it's good to understand that these communities are not homogenous, and therefore we need as well to open our eyes and keep in mind that we're dealing with very diverse groups of people in areas that might seem very specific. So it's at this point I'd like to invite Ole Kaunga, and he'll proceed from here.
Thank you very much. So Laikipia is actually in the central part of Kenya. It's one of the counties that can show you the history of Kenya colonization, and also it's as Kirigia said, the area has different communities, and also it has still a very large part of the county in the hands of very few whites who are left of the independence. So that's a landscape on how the land is distributed. Where is the land and who has it? Times of the regime, here you have the large scale ranches. That is people who own land up to about 80,000 acres. These are the former British settlers. They are still, some of them are Kenyan citizens, but you see 40% of the land is in their hands. So you can say actually 40% of the total land in Laikipia County is in the hands of commercial ranches. Part of them are actually used for conservation as well as beef production. Then we have the large scale farms in terms of by multinationals, say Finley, sometimes back homegrown. They do large scale farming in terms of exporting flowers to London, to Netherlands, and all that kind of thing. So, but at what cost? You come to group ranches. That's now the pastoralists, the Maasai, the Laikipia Maasai are. You see what proportion of the land they occupy. Smallholders, these are agricultural. Apparently, that the smallholders, they are the majority in that county, and they occupy that amount of land. And you see there are quite a number of them. And the land distribution among them could be small, but they are the ones who control politics in that area. Some of the, what I mean by the stub forests, that these are originally government forests intact, but during one of the political regimes, government, they subdivided the land, settled brought in some other communities, settled them there. Some of these forests, like Maramanet, towards the Muruti forest, are gone. Some of then they have intact forests around Mount Kenya. Some of them are in the pastoral regions. And then the gray area, government lands, we have government land. These are holding grounds, stock routes, outspans that were meant for services. Some of them have gone, we cannot really determine to what extent what is really there. Because right now, that's where the problem comes in. Most of that land has gone. It's in the private hand. And there was actually some of the gray, after independence, there's some part of land that was left undefined. You couldn't tell whether it is private, it's public, and it's about 9%. I think it should be down on the last bit of it. And that's where right now is a conflict hot zone. So if you see the like what my colleague said, Evans, you realize that there are quite a number of conflicts running through different land use systems, different livelihood systems. For instance, we have one group. There's a conflict between farmers and farmers, smallholders, between water. Upstream communities competing with with downstream communities for water. We got farmers and pastoralists fighting for water. Access routes to water, and also pasture. Because that farmers are trying to enclose and define their lands, but at the same time, pastoralists will move during different seasons try and access those resources. And then we have pastoralists and conservation. While pastoralists have been coerced by international organizations, local organizations, to set part of the land for conservation. And then they have very limited land. During dry season, they want to advance and access the pasture in the conservation areas. But they are being told this is not for livestock, it is for wildlife. So there is that tension around conservation areas. And you've realized that Laikipia is a pioneer in terms of community-based conservation. Further north is even more drier. So during the dry season, the pastoralists from northern Kenya move towards Laikipia, southwards. Then for instance, right now when there's no rains, there's very high tension always in Laikipia because of all this pull and push because of competition for different resources that are very, very limited. And then we have pastoralist to pastoralist conflict and tug of wars. We have the Laikipia Maasai, we have the Samburu, we have the Pokot. At that time, wanting to access different area and they compete and sometimes it can be clashes, bloody clashes. This normally happens during the dry season. In dry season, all the conflicts are pronounced because the resources are diminishing. Then we have a conflict between the large scale landowners, the ranchers, and the pastoralists. They have issues about, at some point, actually, the pastoralists forcefully get into the ranches, which are normally fenced, and they act to access water. There's a lot of arrests, illegal grazing, all these kind of things. For instance, this year has been very bad for the pastoralists. And then we have pastoralists, farmers, investors. What I mean by investors, we have rich people coming in. You know, Laikipia is very interesting. We see Mount Kenya during the it doesn't experience a lot of drought as such. So it's more we see a lot of people coming from Zimbabwe, South Africa, do for holiday homes and they fence off. So every year, big chunks of land is going that were formerly accessible for pasture, and then we have. The pastoralist conflict with conservation NGOs. This is a new scenario where we see big conservation NGOs like the National Conservancy, the African Wildlife Foundation, buy land in the name of community-based conservation, then end up excluding communities. It is the illicit. For now, TNC is managing about two or three big ranches or conservation areas in Laikipia. So that's another scenario. NGOs, the green kind of grab, so they buy and then exclude. They say it's community-based conservation, but at that, it becomes a private conservancy. This now, these pictures depict the real conflict. We visited here with Mordecai. That's a land that has been just bought. Someone fenced it and then dug a big trench, to exclude pastoralists. And then he realized that the pastoralists decided to retaliate. They burnt that caterpillar. They cut all the wires. And if you see further, you see greenhouses coming up. See, so that's an investment. But that's areas that were accessible by pastoralists. Not far, early this year. But right now, they can't access it. And you see, of course, in the fringes of the fences, the pastoralists struggling. What can be done? One of the things that you see, pastoralists are moving. This was one of the meetings that happened recently in September, where pastoralists now have come together to try and decide to really, what can we do? How can we engage the government? A number of things that can be done is that the pastoralists are organizing themselves for the county government and national government to open access corridors to water points and also government forests, like Mount Kenya, where they have always accessed, and for the terms to be renegotiated. The other thing is, it's not possible for each for every community to exclude itself. You have really to have a community-based inclusive, community-based resource management plans where you can at least decide how to utilize those personal natural resources like water. The other thing is, of course, the issue about police. Well, Simil spoke about this morning about laws that are really recognize pastoralism as a legitimate source of livelihood, because right now it's being undermined by conservation and other forms of investment that the government sees as very legitimate, like horticulture and tourism and that. The other thing is also research. Research is very important to inform policy. That's how you can engage the government. But I also think the Laikipia represent a very current and very colonial image of Kenya. And the Maasai are claiming back their land up to about that's taken away from them during the colonial times. So this land needs to be restituted in a way. But you have to have a law that recognizes, I mean, a way to implement a specific law in the constitution about historical land injustice. Thank you so much. Welcome to your discussion.
Thank you. Now we're fortunate to have as our discussant, Ween from the University of Oslo.
Well, thank you. These were really inspiring and brilliant and thought-provoking papers, and it's a pleasure to be a discussant for this. And I would like to draw attention to the need to attend to the details. I'm an anthropologist, right, in these stories. Because we all know that the devil is in the details. And these details are central to how collaboration, knowledge sharing, and shared decision-making can take place. And so with Mordecai Ogada, what narratives are we acting within in these stories? What does it imply in terms of ambition, agenda, knowledge flows, kinds of expertise included, dissemination processes, decision making? What allowances are made with regard to local nature practices? Is there openness in terms of negotiations over what is nature, what is an animal, to whom? What is meant by protection? What cause and effect relations are foregrounded? Narratives are also calibrated in models. And in both Kenya and Inner Mongolia, these papers speak to what to do when nature or our models do not cooperate. So with us as academics or as pastoralists, it points to the need to think about what our models do in Mongolia or in Kenya. And this, the Mongolian example, I think was a really good example of this term actionability, because it's interesting to think with, because it so obviously connects model and standpoint. What is really active or passive, and to whom? And what does it mean in terms of approaches to environment? In these questions, the notion of scale is vital. Our models, as academics, we can make them speak to each other across law, conservation, and development. And these models are flexible, they're ever expandable. Local knowledges, however, may also be very flexible and resilient, but they're not scalable in the same way as these global models. And I think it is interesting what awareness of this does with our attempts to include it all in conservation governance models, in our efforts to equally engage and include across different standpoints. Thank you.
Okay, now we can open it up to questions. And because everybody stayed so well on their time, even though we started 20 minutes late, we still have, well, at least 20 minutes before our break for coffee. So if we can maybe have the microphones coming around. I see up front here.
Is that ahead?
Yeah.
Thank you to the members of the panel. It was a very interesting talk and conversation. And I would like to emphasize what several of our colleagues from Africa have highlighted on the need to maintain a critical perspective towards any actions, all actions that are tied to conservation and development that lead us to large organizations that are following strong economic and political agenda. And sometimes because we are so needy on money for doing our research or our development actions, we forget that we might be feeding onto this model and perpetuating actions that are the ones that are not in the right way because we have failed so much. And Peter Brown was giving us a very interesting view on that, historical view. So one example is what has happened in the region where I work, where, for instance, UNESCO is trying to protect cultural heritage, and there has been some newer discussions that highlight that these initiatives, local initiatives that have received some recognition from UNESCO as intangible cultural heritage, have generated opposing local reactions that have created more problems instead of protecting the cultural heritage. So this leads us to replacing an imperialistic model, like a modern version of imperialism, for a neo-colonial model that is has been substituted by money and capitalism. So it's like a, I am really amazed to see that we have like an old version of imperialism in those images that you showed that are so strong and that are present in the present day. It's incredible. But there are other things that can be done and do not require a lot of money. We need money, of course, to function in this world. But for instance, the example that you were giving on forest restoration and agroforestry combined with pastoralism, I think these alternatives should be more explored instead of continue looking at knowledge in compartments, trying to generate newer ways of theorizing and generating concrete actions that incorporate traditional knowledge, which is very valuable, with scientific knowledge, and try to transform them and to adapt them to our modern world. We cannot revive the traditional world or the way the world used to be, but we can generate newer and less damaging alternatives that adapt to the world where we are. So I would question whether we actually require a lot of money, because traditional societies have not used money and have been resilient for so many years, too many years, decades, centuries. So I would question that money tied on conservation directly and development.
Did you ask, did anybody want to respond to that, or we'll leave it as a comment, statement? Philippe and Mordecai?
Okay, I'm in agreement that that money has, in reference to East Africa, I think money has poisoned a lot of the discourse around things. I'm from an ecological background, and ecologists have been the explorers sent ahead by pirates before they come and take stuff. And the fact is, we've been told for many years that in order to argue against other land use types, you have to put monetary value on things. And I think it was Rob Fletcher who said that that's the best way, is you tie somehow very tight in his ideas, or what he thinks are his ideas. Because I've read in literature, for example, that Mount Kenya forest, someone worked out a value of $6 billion for it. And I thought that was ridiculous, because if someone came with, there are a lot of people in this world with $6 billion. I wonder if that meant we could sell him Mount Kenya forest. But a lot of the values, places being lost to tourism facilities, are the most valuable parts of these landscapes, the forests where some of these communities are doing initiations, the springs where some of them go to bathe or fetch water, the forests where they get medicinal plants. Those are all the areas that are being excised and excluded for tourism facilities. And I think trying to put monetary value is something on everything, especially nature. And the much touted paradigm of payment for ecosystem services, It's a poisoned chalice, in my opinion. Yeah,
thanks for your intervention. And I would like even to go farther away than that. You mentioned alternatives like forest restoration and agroforestry, but I think even those concepts are dangerous ones. And there is I don't mean the idea is bad, but I mean that these are already concepts that are used by the machinery of the aid to development and conservation. And as soon as you say agroforestry or forest conservation, there's a whole machine behind, you know, there's a whole machinery of intervention. And actually, it's like pushing a button. You use those keywords, you get money. But the condition is that you don't just do agroforestry, you do it in a certain way that's the one that is going to flatter that machinery. And then you actually bring another neocolonial project in the arena. So, I mean, we have to do it while forgetting the concept. You're right, on the picture you saw agroforestry, but please don't call it agroforestry, because then it's the end of the story.
I think there are certain things that government and conservationists do that creates even that weaken even conservation in the end of it. One thing is that in the process of pushing pastoralism to the edge of survival, a number of people fall off the system every other time. This, I don't know if anyone has done, but to me, this and separating wildlife from people for the first, those who fall off from the pastoral system become poachers. They have to live, they have to survive. And they have known that this wildlife, we used to think is part of, they are part of us, a part of our ecosystem. But they have now, you've created a certain, they delink themselves totally from that. And there's a link between poverty and poaching. The poachers come use those pay, little handoffs to those young people who have fallen off the system to kill an elephant because they know the route. They have the traditional knowledge. They know all the route. They know everything. So one thing they are trying to promote, and they don't know, and probably they need to be told that they don't know, that they're actually weakening the system themselves by advancing it, pushing it too much at the expense of, pastoralism supports about close to 6 million people in Kenya, pastoralism alone, it's a resilient system that that something can be done by co-management, but we don't need to think about co-management right now. We need to partnerships where indigenous peoples take the lead in terms of conservation. Others need to come and join them in what they have always been doing.
Thank you. It's the microphone, so we'll go here and then over to this table.
Oh, thank you. Thank you very much. I also wanted to stand to thank the our brothers and sisters who have presented these issues in a very, very honest way. So thank you very much, Asante-san. I think this has touched me as a person, as an elder from the same community of people we've been talking about. And my problem is, it's not the first time, really, I hear these stories. What makes me so think very deeply is anybody out there listening, really? Or we're just talking? And that to me is not a question to you, but to our brothers and sisters who are seated here. Is anybody listening? I heard another brother this morning who is fighting for the people here in Quebec. You call it Quebec? And I read your statements of people say it takes only one man to change the world. Why can't our world there be changed by so many of us who are here, who are researchers? Why is it so difficult for the so many who are learned, who have the pen and the computer on the other hand? Why can't you roll words in your computers, in your universities, that speaks loud to what is happening on the ground to save livelihoods, to save life? When we talk about conservation in my own country, a day before I came here, I went to see my livestock. My father is married to 8 wives. Each wife had an average of 9 children. My brothers are married to many. I went to visit them just a day before I came here. When I arrived there at 10, that's when livestock were now flocking, coming to take water. All the water from the sand rivers have been drunk by elephants that night. So there's no water. And cattle are crying, wanting water. And this is our land. And the elephant walked majestically into the Tarangire National Park. We're not allowed to go there. We felt so bad. I asked the young fellows, the warriors with spears, what can we do? They say there's only one solution. Burn the park, kill the elephants. I said, that is dangerous. Don't try that. Because those, your cattle will die and nobody will come. One elephant will die and everybody will come with choppers and helicopters. That is the situation. I see one thing. Everything that is being repaired by money in Eastern Africa, Kenya, Uganda, Tanzania, people are repairing things that have not been broken. It's not broken, but repair is done. And that is wrong. Why repair something which is not broken? In terms of the pastoral system that is there, it's working, it's perfect, John Galati was explaining to this, it went in my heart because it's real. Why repair? Second thing, the voices. Why are voices not the voices? These are voices of the voiceless. Nobody listen. Nobody, you know. So the voices of the voiceless have produced one thing, a culture of people who, at the end of the day, all you need to do is to say, ah, Mungu, that's God. You just say, ah. The voice disappears in you. This is a sign of the powerlessness inside marginal people like pastoralists. Why can't a computer save us today if you are good in writing? Why is it that people, why is it that, sorry, I'm getting a little bit excited. Please forgive me. I know we operate on time here. Whereas I come from a flexible time, please forgive me so that I say a few words only. Why are the narratives that you are talking not really transformative? Why? Why are your narratives so silent? Why are your narratives so weak? What is wrong with that computer? That's my question, and it's probably a question for everybody. And the oppressor, why do you look at the eyes of the oppressor and still keep quiet? Why? Is the oppressor part of you, part of the system? Why is the oppressor inside you, and yet we are all silent? Sorry for my English, but I feel this is the question I want to ask. The oppressor is inside the regime that carries the narrative. And therefore, it cannot be changed until we change something that I can't explain in English. But the word oppressor is very important for me because it's then the difficult one. And finally, partnership that my brother Ole Kaunga said and proposed that is the way forward is the only magic in front of us. But if this partnership, I recognize partnership, if I say in English, as a relationship of two, maybe more, who are equal. My brother, we are not equal. Therefore, the partnership that you are proposing is going to be very difficult. I think let's accept one thing, the culture of silence. Thank you.
Perhaps we'll go to this table, and we have to be mindful of time, unfortunately. So we'll have our two speakers here, and then if there are any responses, and then I think we'll break for our coffee break.
Well, thank you very much, and thank you the entire panel for a very interesting presentation. My question really to the team, and probably to well, I think through the team in generally, one of the challenges generally we are facing is what I can call a poor governance and bad leadership within the big international conservation organization. The story in Laikipia about ANWF, Conservancy International are a very good example. And my question is, if you have some ideas, this international conservation organization collude with the political elite at the national level and then carry serious human violation on the ground as they push their agenda. Two questions. Question number one, is there any innovation that this conservation organization become accountable? Because at the moment, they are carriers of impunity, so to speak. That's question number one. So is there any way this international organization can be accountable? Because at the moment, absolutely they are not. Number two, is there any way research can bring dialogue between indigenous peoples, globally or regionally, and the owners of this organization to the table, is there any way research can be done to bring on board a dialogue between the conservation industry and indigenous peoples so they get to know the problem and the suffering they are causing among indigenous peoples? Thank you.
Thank you very much for the panel, for a wonderful presentation. I just have a question to Zhang on the presentation in Mongolia. In late 2008-2009, we had a major drought which affected East Africa. And part of that was attributed to climate change. And one of the solutions that has come towards addressing what is now called climate risk is insurance. Previously, it was said that pastoralists, people who cannot, because of the nature of how they live, so dispersed and so on, the insurance system could not serve them. But now there are ways to do weather-based insurance, weather index insurance. And this is important because it actually links to the presentation on the Northern Kenya, because there's a big project to scale up, to pilot and scale up weather insurance for pastoralists in Northern Kenya. But I understand part of this was tested in Mongolia. So my question is, do you know about that pilot program in Mongolia? And what, if you do, what were the results and findings? And do you think actually insurance solutions could be part of the solutions towards addressing drought risk among pastoralists?
And thank you for your question. And I know a little bit about Mongolia, this pilot project in Mongolia, and actually it not worked as the expectation, because from 2008 and 2009, there is also very big snow disasters in Mongolia, and it is very, because when there is the winter disaster, snow disaster, the traffic is totally blocked, and so it is very difficult to calculate the loss. And so I heard that it is not work as expectations, but I don't know the true reason of it. And in China also, there is some people is talking about this kind of insurance policies, but we didn't implement this kind of insurance. And I think the herders, it is out of herders' idea, I think. Thank you.
Thank you, Mordecai.
Quickly, in response to what Elias Morindat said, and also partly what Joseph Simmel just said, it is not easy. As I said, I'm from the background of ecology, and I understand, not that doesn't mean I condone, but I understand the culture of silence, that indeed it is a culture of silence, as Elias said. I know I'm not from any pastoralist group, but I'm from a very marginalized group that's hardly known. It's called the Black African Wildlife Ecologist. This, I'm sure all of you have watched Discovery Channel, National Geographical. How many Black African wildlife ecologists do you see on your screens? Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. It's a fact that conservation in the model that's being practiced in East Africa now, in much of sub-Saharan Africa, is conservation by Western standards for a Western market funded by Western money. And ecologists, we've become sort of slaves to the grants and the papers. When you're sponsored by Safari Club International, you say the country's crawling with lions because Safari Club wants to hunt them. When you're sponsored by International Fund for Animal Welfare, You say there are three lions left and they're dying. That's just, I'm sorry, but that's what natural science has become in much of the countries where we come from. So we are facing a situation where the untruths have been really slickly marketed. Large conservation organizations invest heavily in PR and communications offices. The injustices I talk about here are funded by big money, and I'm talking about USAID, I'm talking about governments, Netherlands government, Swedish government, Danish government, DFID, as in UK government. So there's serious money behind this, and careers depend on it. So there are very few people who are willing to sacrifice, but we must speak up. Personally, I've often broken that code of silence, and I've paid the price that people do pay for that. Right now, I'm just finishing writing a book with an environmental writer about just all this. And it has to be done. It's very difficult, but we must try, because otherwise our positions get cemented and they get commodified. I'm sure all my Maasai brothers here can testify as to how their culture and what they do has been turned into a commodity rather than valued as a culture. Even Kenya government tourism posters show Maasai women in beads and all that, and it's been put into a pigeonhole. And it pains me, even though I'm not Maasai, it pains me when I see it. But we must speak out. The voices are not many. I agree with Elias, the voices are not many. And so many of us, particularly those of us in the biological end of things, are more interested in surviving, are more interested in acknowledgement of their peers, are more interested in research papers and research grants than the truth that's out there. It's unfortunate, but we must try, and indeed we will.
Yeah, I think about what Olesimil asks about can international conservation organization be held accountable. To me, we have the Indigenous People's Movement needs to reawaken and know how to engage this. Mm-hmm. I know one organization that are really trying to engage into these aspects of advocacy. Survival International is putting a lot of, and it does not accept money from government for legitimacy of what they are doing. But we have to do it ourselves. The other thing also, how research can inform and support this work is we need to move away from a monetary scale of measurement. We have to monetize something for it to be measurable. I think we need, and the moment you monetize anything like heritage, which the Maasai treated conservation as part of heritage, they value it that way. The moment you target with a price, then you have broken. You are now advancing a monetary value rather than that invisible and the very much important and fundamental part of that. And that's what we have done to conservation. We've just commercialized it. So people are away from it. They were not doing it for commercial purposes. They are doing it because of that interrelated, more or less symbiotic relationship between indigenous livelihood and occupations and nature. So to me, research universities can do two things: organize such a forum at some point, and conservation organization, so that bring dialogue between indigenous peoples and people who are facing to be extinct in terms of, in their livelihood, are facing extinction, while so much is being put to advance conservation that will have no basis, will permanently require money to support conservation in the future. If pastoralism become weakened, that is the only form of livelihood that is more or less close and supports conservation without any funding. And that's how it is. The system has become, that's how the system of support has worked all through. You see, it didn't require, for, you find young children evading elephants, and they still look after their cattle. So to me, we need a radical kind of somebody to take up what's the other way we can measure these things. I mean, the UNESCO say intangible culture, but for them to understand that, they monetize it. That we are saving Mount Kenya, it's now a UNESCO heritage site. You know, Kenya is saving a lot of millions. See, but for who and from where? Mm-hmm. So thank you.
Thank you, Jacques.
Yeah, I want to thank Alois for his intervention and to mention that many academics share this frustration. Academics talk and write. Basically, that's what we do. But many academics had another job before to become an academic and may have been in policy making. I take just my example. In 1992, my job was, you know, to promote a stupid agroforestry technology that didn't make any sense to farmers. And my job in 1996 was to kick out, you know, communities, local communities from the forest to plant trees that will be later on turned into a citrus plantation for local elites, you know. So when you do a career, you know, in the policy making, this is what you have to do. So in the end, maybe an academic is the only space that is remain and open to people having some kind of critical thinking, and it's a lot of frustration. So thanks for reminding that.
Yeah, for my part, I'll add more to what you've said, John, as well, and also to reiterate what Liza said. It seems we already have a lot of knowledge in this house, in this room, and one of the things as academics or researchers that seems to have a gap in is in terms of policy influence. Because we've gathered a lot of information and we are still gathering a lot of information about the challenges that are being faced by different groups. But we do realize that even though our governments do recognize and are aware of the challenges that are happening on the ground, still we have a lot of work to do to actually convince them to do what they know already is right. So what can we do as well to make sure that those policies are really enforced in a manner that they can actually, what we know is right and what should be really implemented, because producing knowledge without having a really tactful way of how we can put it into use, in the end we will have a lot of work to do, and we will be going in cycles and reaching a point where we don't really get to our goal because of this policy block. And I'm very motivated to be part of the academic world, but I'm also willing to contribute in every way possible with everyone's support. And to reiterate the other point about the understanding the dynamics of cultural or specific context. When we understand, for instance, that in Laikipia, where we show different livelihoods and different groups existing there, we need to also, that one makes us understand that it's not just about the pastoral groups and the government, but there are also a lot of other dynamics that happen amongst the groups. And so, For policy to also be influenced, it has also that the leaders have to also always have to look at other groups as well and see that they do not favor one group without, or they take strategic measures, and therefore we need to see it as a whole, and therefore not just look at pastoral groups as if it's only the pastoral groups that are there, but understand those dynamics in a manner that we don't leave any other stones unturned. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, everyone. Thank you for your interventions, your questions, comments, and thanks to the panelists for giving us lots to think about. I encourage you to connect with them at the coffee break and after. So join me in thanking our panelists and our discussant. Thank you.